Hello friends, good afternoon. Welcome to CEC-UGC Network. And as you know, we are having lecture series on Sardar Patel. Today we will be having lecture on Patel and his economic vision regarding independent India. For this, we have our special guest, subject expert, Dr. Neerja Singh, Associate Professor, Department of History, Satyavati College Evening, University of Delhi. We had a lecture on Patel's view on zamindari evolution in our last lecture with Dr. Singh, and today we'll be having his views on economic vision regarding independent India with the Dr. Singh. So without wasting much time, I would like to welcome Dr. Singh to our show and request him to begin his lecture.
Thank you, Smita. In the last lecture, we had series of till now three lectures, and we have been discussing Patel's social vision, his position on social issues, and his position on zamindari abolition. Today, I'll be presenting a general vision of Patel on economic issues, or what his vision was of independent India, or trajectory of the path of the development vis-a-vis independent India. Patel was supporter of democracy, secularism, civil libertarian welfare state system rooted in social, political, economic equality and social justice. Before Patel and other Gandhian leaders, they had three paradigms in front of them to choose from. One was the socialist paradigm of development, second was the Gandhian paradigm of development, and third was the British model, which was characterized by utilitarian capitalist welfare model of development. However, Patel's conviction on what kind of, or what the trajectory of the development path should be, emanated from both the Gandhian ideology and from the British model. However, he was also influenced that since justice and equality should be the foundation, therefore elements of socialistic should be, Gandhian socialism should be incorporated in whatever the development path of free India should be. British linked India with the world capitalism without India becoming industrialized, and British rule led to colonization of Indian economy and created much problems like depeasantization, deindustrialization, indebtedness of peasantry, landless labor, rural capitalist, absentee landlordism, sub-infeudation, and so on. And on this, the views of the moderate and extremist were accepted by Patel. How the moderates and extremists characterized colonialism, what in their perception was the nature of British rule, the issue of drain, he accepted it. And he also accepted the concept of modernization vis-a-vis India. What should be the nature of modernization? What kind of modern nation they thought of India to become? And in that, therefore, Patel accepted the policy and program elaborated and elucidated by moderates and extremists. Therefore, on anti-colonial ideology, on nature of development, nature of the independent, what should be the vision, what should be the economic growth, or what pattern the economic growth or development should happen in independent India, was largely rooted in the ideology, in the conception, perception of the moderates and extremists. Patel regarded his focus, his focus largely was on a strong center, a well-equipped modern army, economic contentment and responsible citizenship, and a firm administrative fabric he regarded as the essential requisites as well as expression of the of that unity and strength. Patel very categorically stated that since Patel, like the other Gandhian leaders of the national movement, accepted the definition which the moderates and extremists provided regarding the nature of British rule, how they were siphoning off the surpluses of India, their understanding on the issue of drain and deindustrialization. So Patel accepted and moved forward. Now his focus was to translate that understanding into action. Therefore, they accepted the definition, the characterization which was provided by moderates and extremists. On that issue, there was no differences. He further elaborated without defining anti-colonialism, without defining or without commenting on drain and deindustrialization or the economic impact of British rule, he carried it forward. He further elaborated it he said that the India is being milched, India is a milch cow for the Britishers. They are draining it, bleeding it white, they are siphoning off the surpluses, and Patel said that our position is that of a milch cow. We are not properly looked after even though we provide milk. So he is elaborating on anti-colonial, on the issue of drain and the impact. He carries it forward. He does not provide a new definition. He carries it forward. He accepts how moderates and extremists looked at the British rule. Second, he says British people want to rule over us because they want to continue their trade with India. They want to strengthen their trade with India, and to do that, they play all sorts of games with us. We are fools that we don't understand their tricks, and thus they take away our gold from India. Thus, day by day, we are becoming poorer and they grow fat at our own expense. As long as the British remain in India, we are not going to be happy. A time will come when the British will have to give the reins of the kingdom in our hands, and they shall have to go back from where they had come, and according to me, that time is now imminent. Therefore, Patel had the understanding, Patel understood the what impact or what kind of rule the Britishers are providing. However, he was, since according to Patel, there were the impact was creating crisis and impacting the peasantry as well as the labor, the landless labor, and he further elaborated it by saying that regardless of these I am quoting from Patel's speeches and his writings, regardless of the hunger which is the constant companion of millions of Indians, the government is spending crores of rupees on its army and is looking after its own people. Its officers, the members of the ICS, are the highest paid in the world, and they are spread throughout the country, and they are governing the surplus, the salary, the income they are drawing is from the surpluses which has been produced by the sweat and blood of the landless laborers and the peasantry, and it is they who are living like a parasite on their income. But how far this is going back, returning in improving the condition of the peasantry and the landless laborers, on whose surpluses these ICS or the British facade, this institution, this paraphernalia is surviving on. Patel questions it, and he is invoking the peasantry to have an understanding of the British rule. He by saying these, he wants to convey to the people of India that it is not simply a foreign rule, it is a rule which has colonized the Indian economy, society, culture, and it is something which is very, very different from the earlier kind of foreign rules. Therefore, he further elaborates it by saying there was a time when in their free time the farmer could find some cottage industry or the other which could help him to supplement his income. The main cottage industry was the production of cloth. In millions of home of farmers, the charkha was plied daily and yarn was spun. That gave employment to millions of weavers. That gave employment to craftsmen who manufactured charkhas, looms and carding machines. The foreign rulers have through diverse ways encouraged their own industries and have in the process taken away the employment of millions of farmers and craftsmen and have placed them in a position where they have nothing to do. He says this is the impact of the British rule, this is the impact of the land revenue policy, this is the impact of the so-called their claim that they have been modernizing Indian economy by introducing all the modern digits which are existing or which they have introduced in Britain. However, it is failure on the parts of the Indian not to work upon these policies, work upon these opportunities and improve their condition. On anti-colonial ideology, Patel links it with his economic vision, and since he accepts the moderate's definition of anti-colonialism, he further adds to it, he elaborates to it, and accepts that the anti-colonial ideology is very essential to meet the challenge for the redressal of the British rule, to meet the challenges which is being in the name of modernization, in the name of improvement, the colonialists are propagating. The anti-colonial ideology of the Patel hinged on the moderate's concept of socio-economic and political vision of the movement, which would be realized by achieving Swaraj and establishing a democratic, civil libertarian welfare state based on social, political and economic equality. His vision of Swaraj was same as emanated from the Gandhian ideology. He accepted Gandhian ideology that Swaraj based on non-violence, equality and justice will be the true Swaraj for the Indian people and for India. For him, Swaraj could not be real for the masses unless it made possible the achievement of a society in which democracy could extend from political to the social and economic sphere, and in which there would be no opportunity for the privileged classes to exploit the bulk of the people nor for gross inequalities as it existed then. Therefore, he saw true democracy, true economic democracy existing in village Swaraj, in village community, by strengthening the rural, by strengthening the rural India, by strengthening the peasantry and by strengthening the village and making it self-sufficient, self-reliant and on the principles of Swadeshi. Sardar Patel in his speech at Bombay on 30th December 1935 said that the mission of the Congress was twofold, and on this he was very clear that we have to carry on the struggle for independence, side by side building institutions based both on Gandhian ideology and British model, because he always had the history of India at the back of his mind when he talked about his talked over his economic or political or social vision of what Indian independent India should be. And he clarified, he categorically insisted that the Indian past, Indian from Indian history, one can see, one can realize, one can understand that because of certain weaknesses either in technology or in the knowledge system, the nation always surrendered to foreign invasions, and therefore a village Swaraj, village based on the Gandhian ideology of panchayat system, will only survive when we have strong center and strong economic base. And therefore he said that for he told the masses that in front of Congress there are two important missions, one to carry on the struggle for independence, and on the other the Congress should build up national institutions which will further strengthen the nation. Further elaborating on what kind of national institutions he envisaged during peacetime, Patel said on 17th October 1935 that for the people of British India as well as for the people of Indian states, he supported establishment of responsible government, ensuring fundamental rights of citizenship like freedom of person, speech, association and the press. Theoretically, Patel accepted the relevance of Gandhian vision of parliamentary Swaraj based on panchayat system. According to him, it would represent sovereignty of the people based on pure moral authority and devoid of violence. And the tools with which such a system would be perpetuated, according to Patel, were concept of panchayati raj, trusteeship, charkha, village industry, basic education, removal of untouchability, communal harmony, prohibition and organization of labor as Mazoor Mahajan. There were two options before Patel regarding the Swaraj: either to opt for Gandhian egalitarian, non-violent, non-exploitative human society, or the society based on Western civic culture. Patel was struggling like other his contemporaries to amalgamate the best of both. Clarifying his position, Patel further stressed, and this I am quoting from Patel's speech, "If we want to carry on government, there are only two ways of doing it. One is the path laid out by Mahatma Gandhi, that is the establishment of Ram Raj, in which there is complete peace, freedom from crime and coercion of any kind. All of us should try to achieve that consummation. But undoubtedly, we cannot reach to that goal overnight. The alternative to it is a firm government backed by a strong army, strong navy, strong air force and a strong police, but ultimately governed by the will of people." And he said that because there were oppositions to Patel's argument and Patel's suggestion and Patel's position on economic issues and political issues. Socialists were there at criticizing the Gandhi's non-violent model of development, non-violent method of restructuring and reconstruction of the colonial India, which had recently gained independence. And to that, Patel's reply was, "Many say that we should adopt Gandhiji's program, but they hardly realize that the government which has to maintain the army must have industrial installations too." By saying this, Patel was not contradicting, not going against the understanding of Gandhiji or the program or the policy or the ideology propounded by Gandhiji. He was as clear on both the issues that whatever be the developmental model of independent India should contain both the Gandhian value system and the demands of the modern age. And therefore, he said this, that to realize, to establish modern state, a strong industrial installation is required, and for that, I am quoting again from Patel's speech, for that quote, for that we must have industrialization. Some say that we should not industrialize it, but build our country on rural life. I spent a lifetime with Gandhiji. I am not a fool to forget his teachings. I also want village self-sufficiency. But what is the position in which you find yourself? Villagers are forsaking the villages for cities. If we do not have industries, what will happen? Will villagers equip the army? Will they supply all the transport, guns and ammunitions, petrol, steel, clothing and other things which a well-equipped army must possess? Instead of looking at the problem one-sided, we have to do justice to both towns and villages. Patel had empathy with Gandhi's concept of parliamentary Swaraj. The heart of Patel beat in unison with Gandhi's vision, but his mind, remembering the history of the nation, favored strong central government. Patel therefore stood for strong center and army based on industrialization. But he also said that the economy of India should be based on twin pillars of agriculture and industry, and not one should be subservient to the other, but they both should complement each other. Speaking in favor of a strong state, Patel said, quote, I am prepared to admit that if the Indian government is to be run today on the basis of Gandhian philosophy without army, I am prepared to change the whole thing. Tomorrow, the whole of India will be run over from one end to the other if you do not have strong army, unquote. Therefore, Patel was very clear about what the need of the time was: a strong center, a well-equipped modern army, economic contentment and responsible citizenship, and a firm administrative fabric, according to Patel, were the essential requisites as well as expression of unity and strength. For him, democracy and civil liberty was as essential for a strong economic base as it was needed for a strong political base for the growth of Indian society and nation. According to him, he regarded democracy as a system which thrived on the rationale of civil liberties. According to him, civil liberties, which included freedom of press, freedom of speech, freedom of expression and the freedom of association, was the lifeline of any modern and modern nation based on the Enlightenment values of humanism, social equality and social justice. According to him, therefore, Patel was against unconditional freedom. He wanted freedom with discipline, with responsibility, and therefore, according to him, civil liberty must have the full scope in Congress regime. He said, please note the adjective civil before liberty. The moment you drop the word civil, liberty will then mean license. No responsible government can allow license or unlimited liberty to the people. If the criminal liberty of a few persons should be restrained for exercise of the civil liberty of lakhs of law-abiding citizens, and if the Congress ministries fail to impose restrictions on those few, then they will be failing in duty. He, to a very important Congress leader, S.K. Patil, he advised what should be the responsibility if a member of Congress party runs newspapers, and how he should stick to the values of the civil values of liberty and freedom. I'm quoting from Patel's speech, to quote, a newspaper in the hands of an office bearer of an important Congress organization is a dangerous weapon and can often be successfully used to mislead public opinion by suppressing the truth and also by propagating untruth. Unless the man holding that office has the courage to face unpopularity, risk his office and even incur the displeasure of his colleagues for the sake of standing by the truth and exposing fraud, hypocrisy and untruth. This is a difficult task. I frankly confess that you are not according to my judgment and equal to that task. My advice to you would be, resist the temptation of taking the responsibility of running a newspaper until you are mentally, morally and financially equipped adequately for the task, which to my mind is not so easy as is supposed to be. I hope you will not take this amiss. I understand your difficulties and your delicate position, but we who have braved hardships and borne sufferings have not done so far, depriving our soul, and we are expected to have greater moral courage than the normal run of people to stand by truth in spite of difficulties and embarrassments. Patel also laid important stress and attention to planning. He said that planning is very, very essential for a wholesome growth of a nation, and that to a nation which for such a long period was a colony, whose economy, society, moral values, culture were colonized, were subjugated, were subservient to a nation, a powerful industrialized nation, and whose self-image was totally shattered, and therefore to rebuild and generate confidence, sense of Swaraj, sense of Swadeshi, sense of self-respect requires planning, and it should be multifarious, multidimensional. And on the issue of planning, there were debates. People have been suggesting that Patel never opposed, but he was for planning by taking the situation into account. It should respond to the need of the hours, and therefore the kind of planning which the socialist was suggesting Patel differed on that. He said the need of the hour was to produce, and then we can talk about distributing it. Socialist insisted on the distribution aspect. Therefore, the confusion and the so-called differences were recorded or were analyzed or were worked upon or were given attention. According to Patel, Patel adopted pragmatic approach towards planning. He accepted it for integration of the country. Being a realist, he knew what was possible and what was not. He was apprehensive over both the approaches on planning, the Gandhian and the socialist. He was aware of the fact that many extraneous factors governed in the success of the planning. First, he laid great stress on realizing internal and external security for the implementation of plan. To quote, "You cannot plan anything, you cannot work on any plan if there is no internal and external security. Therefore, I took to planning for the integration of the country." Secondly, Patel believed that planning, howsoever good, would not work unless we realize our responsibilities and unless we think that it is our obligation to implement these schemes that have been planned, unquote. Thirdly, he believed that industry should increase employment and not reduce it. Therefore, he agreed with the Gandhian understanding of industry and modernization. Gandhi too was not against technology, not against modernization, but he was against profiteering. He was against he was against the authoritarianism of or dictatorship or the subjugation of technology, subjugating people, human values, and surrendering it to industry, which may result in retrenchment, unemployment. Therefore, he wanted industries, but non based on the principles of non-violence. And similar view Patel also subscribed to. And therefore, according to Patel, quote, our planning must necessarily differ from the planning of industrial countries. And here he therefore this substantiate the argument that he did not differ from, but he was practical. He viewed the practical aspect of planning. Industrial countries which are smaller in dimensions or are highly developed industrial countries. He says ours is primarily an agricultural country, and in a country so thickly populated as ours, idleness is the greatest disease. If you want to employ millions of the idle hands, they must be employed in spinning and weaving cloth and in other village industries. So difficult it is to plan purely on a non-industrial basis. We must in certain directions at least industrialize our country rapidly and with all the efficiency needed for it. Otherwise, we are doomed in the modern context of the world. We have therefore to plan for our industry and agriculture in order to meet our primary and immediate needs. And therefore, he emphasized that primacy should not be given to industry. Primacy should be given to consideration, should be given to agriculture. Agriculture should not be subservient to industry, but they should complement each other. Industry should support and complement agriculture, not the other way round. And therefore, Patel highlighted, quote, if the world succeeds in having disarmament all over it, then the scheme of village sufficiency would be an ideal thing to follow. Here he explains the practicality. His views expressed the practical aspect, the implementational aspect of Gandhian ideology. He concentrated on the practical, how far it is practical to implement, how far it can lead to the demands of the time, how far it can answer to the needs of the time. And therefore, he emphasized on the practical aspect of the Gandhian ideology and Gandhian vision. He was not going against the views of the Gandhi. In fact, he was making it approachable, he was making it action oriented, he was making it practical, he was making it which could be implemented and acted upon, which could answer the needs of the time. And therefore, he says in this speech that if the world succeeds in having disarmament all over it, then the scheme of village sufficiency would be an ideal thing to follow. But it is a far dream. Therefore, we have to plan for our industry and agriculture in order to meet our primary and immediate needs. In certain directions, at least, the country has to be industrialized rapidly and with all the efficiency needed for it. Otherwise, we are doomed in the modern context of the world. The modern army is not the army of bows and arrows. It is an army which requires many things which only machine can produce. Apart from arms and ammunition, apart from the uniform and other things that are needful, it needs a large quantity of stores, jeeps, motors, mechanical appliances, aeroplanes and petrol and so many other things. And for that purpose, you must have industries and they should be developed in our own country. Therefore, he was emphasizing on self-reliance and Swadeshi. And therefore, to conclude, in practice, this was to be the guideline for the construction of political and administrative institutions for the governance of the state to which Patel agreed, and the fact that the basic administrative structure of the British colonial government was incorporated with modifications into Free India, and with Patel occupying positions of responsibility and influence, is proof enough as to what kind of political system Patel preferred. However, Patel too sought to it that the values, Gandhian values, were also incorporated in our constitution, and therefore he laid emphasis on that it should focus on village swaraj, on panchayati raj, on the values of sharing, on the humanitarian values of sharing, being considerate towards those who are at the lower rung of the society, and therefore he accepted, and he not only accepted but he also emphasized on the incorporation of the Gandhian concept of Daridra Narayan. He said that the those who are in a better position, who are in a better status, who are at the decision making, who are occupying the seats of power, should have compassion, tolerance, sharing towards, and sense of sacrifice towards those who are at the lower rung of the society, and therefore only that society will succeed which is based on the principles of sharing, compassion, understanding, and sacrificing towards those fellow beings who are not in such an advantageous position, who are the lower rung of the society, who are impoverished, who are weak, who need the support of those who can give and who can offer. And therefore, Patel emphasized on both on strong central government with strong industrial base, with strong agrarian base, along with strong army, strong navy, strong bureaucracy, and strong judiciary, and law and order, and police system. And therefore, but it should be towards people oriented, it should be towards the considering, helping, and taking people's needs and their welfare into account. Therefore, he was treading the middle path, which included both values from Gandhian ideology and values of the British utilitarian parliamentary system. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this insightful lecture. I have few queries regarding this lecture. As you have mentioned that Patel has a strong army, has a view of a strong army for the development of this country, and Gandhi has the ideology of non-violence. Then how the both ideology work together for this country?
Following the Gandhian ideology and incorporating it in the reconstruction and in the building of the basic institutions for India, which could lead to its emergence as a strong nation, there was no contradiction between adopting the Gandhian values and taking from the British parliamentary system, because you can have both the Gandhian values along with the strong nation, along with the strong army and strong industrial foundation, because Gandhian values could also succeed only when the nation, only in a strong nation, a nation where its society is based on values and principles which can strengthen it, which can provide inner strength and also protect and provide security to its to its existence. And the history of India from where the history of India exposed to Patel that we succumbed to and we became weak because of certain lack of whether in terms of knowledge system or whether in terms of technology adaptation, but keeping in pace with the changing times. So Patel, according to Patel, unless we have strong nation, and for strong nation he implied strong security system and strong economy, we cannot implement the Gandhian values and the vision which Gandhi had for the independent India. So even to build India on Gandhian path requires secure, stable, strong nation. So there was no contradiction between what Patel said and the practical aspect of the Gandhian values and the Gandhian vision he emphasized on, and he saw there was no contradiction between the two, and therefore he could forcefully argue on it.
Right. Thank you, ma'am, for this question. I have one other query. Like you have mentioned the pragmatic approach for development or planning of Patel, then how it differs from the Nehruvian ideology or view of on planning?
Nehru's focus on planning emerged from the socialistic influence under the principles of socialism, where emphasis was both on the distribution and nationalization and so on and so forth. Patel's emphasis was more that the need of the hour, because just partition happened, we gained independence, partition happened, economy, society was under extreme chaos and stress, and there was lot of distress of both for political, economic and social as well. So the need of the time, and we had to deal immediately with impoverishment, poverty, which the British rule had given to us, and therefore answer was to produce more and produce in a planned way, focus on those by prioritizing our needs, our requirements, and therefore on that issue he did not differ so much from Nehru. But on distribution aspect he said, let's first priority before the nation is to production, increase production, and then we can talk about it, the distribution aspect. So he was not differing on it, but since Patel died in 1950, he did not had enough time to take care of the other aspects and further, you know, indulge or elaborate on his views on the planning and its implementation also. So therefore one can only assume that, but not much difference between the on this aspect that planning is very, very essential for the planned and wholesome growth of the nation.
Okay, thank you, ma'am. One more thing, ma'am, as you have mentioned a term, civil liberty license. Can you please explain this term?
There was difference, just after the independence, just from 1945-46 onwards, the socialists were asserting and the left groups were demanding, and the debate on civil liberty arose even in the parliament also it happened, and Patel was very clear, very critical. There were many issues, I think we will take it up in the other lecture. Okay. There were many issues which emerged, and because of that differences arose between them, and Patel, they were emphasizing on the carrying on struggle on the socialist principles, on the left lines, on which Patel was very clear that the appropriate time is, it is not the appropriate time, because India is still struggling, partition happening, lot of violence occurring in various places, law and order situation was according to the needs. There were many pressures, and in this, if they start a class struggle, a socialistic revolution, then situation will be very worst, and situation will go out of the hand. Therefore, need is first to deal with the immediate problem, the immediate crisis, and the immediate crisis was both all, not only political and economic, it was also a feeling of self-reliance, of your rebuilding confidence amongst the people, and need to propagate and create an environment of peace, environment of communal harmony, and environment of tolerance. And therefore, when the need is for creating such environment, if you initiate a struggle or any kind of movement in name of people's movement on certain ideology or on certain pattern of strategy which is based on violence, will result in chaos. And therefore, he categorically said that the left force, they talk about civil liberty, they talk about freedom, and carrying on movement and struggle in the name of freedom and civil liberty. But what kind of civil liberty if it is not based on sense of responsibility and sense of discipline? Then this civil liberty can create havoc. Therefore, only civil liberty which is based on sense of responsibility, which is based on values, which is disciplined, can be fruitful, can give results, and which can establish a strong democratic nation, and also build parliamentary democratic traditions, and also will be helpful in establishing strong secular roots. And therefore civil liberty with responsibility is the need of the hour. Civil liberty without civil, only demanding for liberty and creating in the name of freedom, in the name of liberty, creating problem, creating violent situation will not be serving or acting on the principles of civil liberty. And this was the view of Sardar.
Okay. One more question, ma'am, since we have time left and we can discuss more for our viewers. So what are the guidelines and political or economic institution on what Patel agreed for development?
But Sardar Patel, this is what I say, Sardar Patel did not differ from the view or from the pro-Congress program which was articulated and defined by the earlier leaders of Indian National Movement, say Gopal Krishna Gokhale, Firoz Shah Mehta, Surendranath Banerjee, and later leaders. Therefore, he also accepted without great elaboration or going into details of it. He accepted that the modern nation means that it should have a balance of agriculture and industry. It should be based on democracy, principles of communal harmony, tolerance, secularism, ethnic tolerance, and civil liberty, social welfareism, and also on principles of equality and social justice. It should reject hierarchical positioning of society. It should reject all kinds of the various kinds of social ills prevailing in our society, untouchability, position of women, and any society which takes care of all these aspects and includes in its development program, which is inclusive of its all its social groups which reside in that territorial area, their aspirations, their anxieties and response to them will emerge a wholesome, a balanced, a tolerant, a compassionate society. This society will be stable. This society will emerge, will bloom into a balanced, a holistic, bloom with a holistic perspective, and will develop, have a balanced growth, a balanced development. Yes. And therefore, this was the vision of Sardar Patel. However, he was, he also emphasized that there should be balance between industry and agriculture. He said that the agricultural, the socialistic path of development which other group is offering, which is the alternative model, should be understood, should its practical aspect, its need, how far it answers the need of the society should be taken care of. And here he said no violently, no injustice should be done to any particular class or social group. Therefore, on the socialistic model, he was a bit suspicious. He was not very confident about it. He said that privatizing, or nationalizing ownership, or nationalizing the production process, or nationalizing or rejecting private ownership, private concept of private property, is a concept, is a view with which the at the moment nation is not ready, because we have just achieved independence, and the our problems are Herculean, it is immense, and so first we should concentrate, address to those issues, to those problems. These continuing struggle on socialistic path, on the issues which the socialists are raising of nationalizing the production process, of nationalizing the economy, or rejecting private ownership, or accepting the socialist model of development and social growth. We can take it later on when the society reaches certain plateau, certain stability, economic stability, economic growth, then it can be taken up. Immediate the need is to address these problems which have resulted by colonization of our economy and our society.
Okay, okay, thank you, ma'am. Besides economic and social point of view, in ideal political system, what Patel preferred to be in?
Patel was a Gandhian, he remained a Gandhian, okay, and he remained a Gandhian till the end, okay, and besides, but he was a liberal democratic leader. He was open to ideas, he was open to various views. The very fact that the Karachi resolution, which was accepted, was under his presidency, which was very radical and very revolutionary resolution. Mm-hmm. The very fact that the leaders with left orientation, with socialist orientations, became the president of Congress, and he being the one of the major pillars of the Congress organization with his support, this shows how democratic in his thinking and in his attitude Patel was. He welcomed all ideas. Congress Socialist Party in 1934 was formed within the Congress, Indian National Congress, and they existed, they carried on whatever views, and they articulated, they expressed. It's itself is an evidence that the how democratic Patel was, because Patel, he was one of the major after 1920s, one of the major pillars of the of Indian National Congress. So to say that he was authoritarian, dictatorial, and how this is how he was being criticized is not being fair to Patel. When one examines the history of Indian National Congress, and when evaluates and analyzes the role of Sardar Patel, when one will come to know that how democratic, liberal, and true follower of Gandhi and true follower of the principles of freedom of speech, association, thought, action, he was. And that is why so many variations of ideas and ideologies and viewpoints could survive and sustain within Indian National Congress.
Yes, ma'am, thank you. As you have said that he follows the liberalism, Patel has the view of liberalism, then can you please explain for our viewers what the term means, liberalism?
By liberalism, I mean, according to Patel, accepting parliamentary system of government, accepting village concept of village Swaraj, accepting the decentralized political power, accepting concept of liberty, civil liberty, which includes freedom of expression, freedom of association, and accepting the devolution of democracy to all these, in all its spheres, I mean from economic to political to social. And this was the, according to Patel, the understanding or conception of liberalism, that liberalism should pervade, override all political ideologies. It should be the central focus of whatever political institution one conceives of in carrying out governance or carrying out making a strong and stable nation. Therefore, liberalism should be the core value of all political, social, and economic institutions, and also cultural. It should be central focus or the central value of the cultural ethos, liberalism, and compassion and tolerance. And this was how Patel viewed liberalism.
Okay, thank you, ma'am, so much for your clarification on various issue of Sardar Patel. Dear friends, this was our fourth lecture, which is on Sardar Patel, a lecture series which is going on, and we'll be having more lectures on Sardar Patel and his views on various more issues with Dr. Singh in the next few lectures. And if you have any queries, any doubts regarding this lecture, you can write us back on our official email ID, which will be showing just after this lecture. And for the next few lectures on Sardar Patel, keep watching, keep tuning. Thank you so much.
Thank you.